From the JAMA Network, this is the JAMA Medical News Podcast, discussing timely topics in clinical medicine, biomedical sciences, public health, and health policy featured in the medical news section of JAMA.
I'm Jennifer Abbasi, Director of JAMA Medical News. Today, we're bringing you clinical highlights from the American College of Cardiology Scientific Sessions, held recently here in Chicago. Joining me is Dr. Ajay Kirtane, who coordinated deep dive sessions on late-breaking research presented at the conference. Dr. Kirtane is a professor of medicine at the Columbia University Irving Medical Center, where he directs the Columbia Interventional Cardiovascular Care Program. He is also an associate editor at JAMA Cardiology. Thanks for being here, Dr. Kirtane.
Thanks so much for having me. Pretty excited about this.
Awesome. We're going to touch on lots of interesting research today, including good news for marathon runners, new data on semaglutide and type 2 diabetes with comorbidities, a trial of treatment for ANOCA, some potentially surprising findings on fluid intake restriction in chronic heart failure, and the association between different dietary patterns and mortality in people with cardiometabolic disorders. So I'd like to start with the RACER study. This was research on cardiac arrests in people who run marathons and half marathons. This study got a lot of attention when it was published in JAMA during the conference. What was interesting to you about this research?
Well, first, Jen, thanks so much for having me on this podcast. And the ACC is a great clinical meeting for those that want updates in clinical cardiology, which is the type of cardiology that's not only relevant to physicians and practitioners, but also to patients. And so starting with RACER, which is a study of runners, is a super important way to go. Really, the key question is that everybody knows that it's healthy and great to run half marathons and marathons, but we also know that there are patients who don't survive those things. And we would like to get a better idea of what's happening with those patients. Why is it happening? And is there a way of preventing it? And have the ways that we've instituted to prevent it had success? And that's exactly what RACER 2 did. It was a study looking at more recent participation in half marathons and marathons to see how patients did, what the rate of sudden cardiac events was, and how patients survived after that.
Great. So what did we learn from this? The study looked at rates of cardiac arrest in the past versus a more recent time period, and it was good news.
Very good news. Unfortunately, there are still patients that have, or I should say runners, who have sudden cardiac events, and the incidence of having that event occur was not that dissimilar in the most recent period, 2010 to 2023, compared to 2000 to 2009. But what was really important was that the incidence of dying was actually lower. And the reason for that is A, better awareness, and B, the more ubiquitous use of things like automated defibrillators and PR teaching, things like that. So I think that's good news. The other part that was really interesting is that many patients who actually had these events had undiagnosed coronary artery disease. And that leads one to think that if we screen for that up front, then that might be a way to then have patients go forward and then be able to run safely.
Oh, that's interesting. So what would be your recommendation, if any, for patients who are marathon runners?
Look, it's a tough one. I think it has to be age appropriate. You can't just start doing CT scans on everybody who's about to run a marathon. But I think with the right risk factor profile and somebody who wants to really ramp up their exercise, that type of thing, it might be important. And also risk factor control with things like cholesterol lowering, et cetera, would be helpful to those patients. And we hope that that could therefore improve the diagnostics of things like coronary disease.
Okay, moving on. As with many conferences I cover these days, there were several studies presented on GLP-1 drugs, which, of course, are the blockbuster diabetes and anti-obesity drugs. Two big randomized trials looked at semaglutide in people with type 2 diabetes. And spoiler alert, both of these trials had positive findings. So let's start with the SOUL trial. This one investigated major adverse cardiovascular events, or MACE, in people with type 2 diabetes who also had atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease or chronic kidney disease, or both. And the intervention was oral semaglutide. So what did we learn?
Well, like any GLP-1 study, Jen, I mean, these studies are all positive for a variety of endpoints. But what's important about this study in particular is it involved the oral formulation. Most patients are used to the subcutaneously injected formulation of these drugs, the brand name in the U.S. of semaglutide, you know, Ozempic and other names like that. But for diabetes, many people don't want to take the injection. So the question is, does the oral version work as well? You need to actually make the oral formulation such that it gets absorbed in a certain way and it has release of the drug. But what's important to emphasize from this study in almost 10,000 patients is that the drug was well tolerated and it improved outcomes in these patients overall. And so like many other GLP agents studies, this was a confirmatory study, but now with a novel formulation.
So this oral formulation, is this available yet for patients?
It is. And I think that the presenter, Darren McGuire, was asked the question, you know, what would you do first? I think for most patients, you try the injectable version first. But for patients that don't tolerate that, now this is something that could be used. And we'll see, you know, whether insurances, et cetera, approve it for the vast majority of patients.
So let's now turn to the STRIDE trial. This one looked at how injected semaglutide affected walking capacity in people with type 2 diabetes who also had peripheral artery disease, or PAD. Tell us about these findings.
This is super interesting. I think peripheral arterial disease or peripheral vascular disease of the arteries is something that's often underdiagnosed. Patients suffer with this. And to be able to randomize almost 800 patients to semaglutide versus placebo and demonstrate that patients were actually able to walk further is pretty impressive. Obviously, we know about all the cardiovascular outcome benefits, but this is actually like a quality of life benefit that people have. Now, interestingly, the word on the street about this trial was that, well, they didn't control for weight loss. So how do you know that it wasn't just the weight loss that led to the ability to walk longer? Well, I think the way I respond to that is that we know it's very difficult to lose weight, and whether the mechanism is via the weight loss or some other effect of the drug, the fact is these patients in a placebo-controlled trial could walk further, and that's important to demonstrate. So for me, this is probably a really, really important study from the meeting.
So I tend to ask this question of the cardiologists that I speak with about GLP-1 drugs. What's your feeling on them right now in terms of patients with heart disease, type 2 diabetes, et cetera?
Look, there's more and more data demonstrating that these drugs can benefit. I'll actually bring it personally. I've gained some weight recently. My metabolic markers went the typical Indian direction, which is not a good one. But I opted to try to lose the weight by really changing my diet around. We're going to talk a little bit about that a little bit later. But the reason for it was because I wanted to see if I could do that by myself first, and then if not, then use the drugs. But I do think that with all this data on the drugs that are out there, if you have a really motivated patient, it's fine to try what I just suggested. But if you don't, or someone who's struggling or really can't do it, then there are a lot of benefits to these types of drugs. And so for me, that's the way I look at it in my practice.
Let's move on to the Warrior trial. This study focused on women with ANOCA, or ischemia with non-obstructive coronary arteries. Why was this trial important?
This is a super important trial because these patients, and these are patients that have anginal symptoms of some kind, but when you look at their coronary arteries, they don't really have plaque that is causing those symptoms. And so frequently these patients are underdiagnosed, they're undertreated. And so the idea behind this trial was, could you treat that group of patients aggressively with medical therapies and demonstrate a difference in terms of clinical outcomes when compared to conventional care? So it was designed as sort of a practical or pragmatic trial. And you hear a lot about that buzzword, pragmatic trial. One of the problems with pragmatic trials is that they're designed to be able to do a study in an easy, readily available fashion. The problem is that if you don't directly control what's happening in one arm versus the other, then you might end up with no treatment effect because both arms are kind of getting the same level of care. Unfortunately, that's what was seen. This trial stopped early, didn't show any difference between intensive care versus conventional care. But interestingly, the conventional care group of patients had a lot of similar care to what was happening in the so-called intensive care arm. So I think at the end of the day, it's tough because this is a great trial to try to do and conceive of, but the execution of it makes it challenging to come out with firm conclusions in this regard.
So no strong takeaway for you from this trial?
Takeaway for me are two. I think the one is we need to study more in this patient population because they're grossly understudied. And two, we have to make sure when we do our trials that we really, really hone in on isolating the effect of one group versus the other. Otherwise, both groups are going to look very similar.
Okay. The next study we're going to discuss, the Fresh Up trial, questions the established practice of restricting fluids in people with chronic heart failure. And the study suggests this may not actually be beneficial. So was this surprising to you?
Yes, it was, in the sense that when you look at the top line study outcome, fluid restriction to less than 1,500 cc's or 1.5 liters of fluid a day, really didn't show much of a difference in terms of symptomatic benefit. But the devil's always in the details, and you got to dig into what actually happened between these groups. And if you look actually at what their reported fluid intake was, the 1500 group was right around 1500. It was 1480. And the other group, which was supposed to be more liberal fluid intake, was 1764. So that's not a lot of difference between these two groups. Folks that are really fluid restricting are restricting even more than that. And folks that aren't, if they're patients with heart failure, they're smart enough probably to know that if they restrict their fluids a little bit, but maybe not that much to that 1500 level, they'll feel better. So again, an example of a trial that with a negative outcome, but probably driven by the fact that these differences weren't that great between what actually happened between one group or another.
So is this not a practice-changing finding for you?
I don't think so. I think that most people recognize that patients with heart failure need to restrict their fluids in some ways. What's a little bit helpful to see is that those that really restricted heavily, they felt more thirsty. Maybe that's not a good thing for patients. So the standard conventional care, weigh yourself every day, know what you're drinking, know your salt intake. That's probably going to be what's recommended for most patients.
Finally, I'd like to finish up with a study on nutrition. It compared mortality among people with cardiometabolic disorders like obesity, diabetes, or heart disease, who ate healthy plant-based diets versus non-healthy plant-based diets or animal-based diets. And people who stuck more closely to a healthy plant-based diet came out on top in this observational study. How do you interpret this?
These observational studies can be tough because there are factors that correlate with somebody eating one diet or another that are perhaps not adjusted for or figured out when looking at these associations between one thing and an outcome. That having been said, I think there's pretty good evidence out there that adopting plant-based diets in general can be healthy for you. I certainly don't know of a lot of studies showing that it's unhealthy for you. But the issue is that when you often tell people to not do an animal-based diet, go to a plant-based diet, they all of a sudden start eating a bunch of carbs and starches and unhealthy plant-based diet. And so what was nice about this study is they tried to tease that out a little bit. It's an association, and they didn't do the full presentation. It was just a poster. But nonetheless, it seems that eating more green leafy foods, beans, things like that, are better than eating complex carbohydrates, even though you're not eating an animal diet. And so really this element of advanced nutrition, digging deeper into what we are actually putting into our own bodies, is really important for patients. It's also really motivating for many patients because these are things that we can control ourselves. We can't control our genetics, can't control whether we're going to have side effects to medications, but we can control our diet. And so really nice to see more data in this nutrition space because I think a lot of patients want to see that.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Dr. Kirtane. I really enjoyed talking about this exciting new research with you.
Jen, thanks so much for doing this. And really kudos to the JAMA Network for putting forward these podcasts that are really helpful for clinicians and patients alike.
Thanks so much. That's it for this episode of JAMA Medical News. I'm Jennifer Abbasi. This episode was produced by Daniel Masisi at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com. Thanks for listening and join us again next time.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.